Good morning and welcome to the 26th meeting of 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is a decision to take item 5 in private. Are members content to do so? Thank you. So our second item of business is a further evidence session on the Bankruptcy and Diligence Scotland Bill at Stage 1. Today we will hear from frontline money advisers. And I welcome Alan McIntosh, approved money adviser from Advice Talks Limited. Joe McGonigal, Money Advice Training and Development Officer from South Lanarkshire Council, and Natalie Mandel, Money Advice Manager, Dalkeith and Districts Citizen Advice Bureau. Thank you to the witnesses for coming along this morning. If I could ask members and witnesses to keep their questions and answers as concise as possible. If you agree with one of your colleagues on the panel, please don't feel the need to repeat what the colleague has said. Just we're quite happy to hear from, if you have agreement, just hear from one member. I'll now invite Colin Smith to ask the first questions. As you'll know, the bill intends to introduce a mental health moratorium, and the first few questions will focus on that area.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to our panel. As Convener said, the first couple of questions are around the mental health moratorium. Now, the Mental Health Moratorium Working Group has recommended that only those in compulsory treatment should be able to access a mental health moratorium. I'm keen to get the views of the panel, and I know you've made comment on that criteria, but I'm keen just to put on record the views of the panel on that criteria and what this would mean for the clients that you work with.
Okay. Joe McMonagall. Yeah. I was on that working group, and there was a lot of issues discussed in that group. The final report didn't really cover, as you imagine, same as a consultation, same as the committee here. You discuss a lot of facts and figures and evidence. There was a view from us, and certainly I think Sarah Jane at Citizen Advice Scotland, that the fact is that there should be more mental health issues included in this, not just compulsory orders. And it would be down, because there's a lot of significant health issues, people in the community, as you probably see from South Lanarkshire Council submission. There's a lot of people in the community who are getting care and support, but it's both social care, NHS as well. So it's not just people who are who are detained in a psychiatric ward at a hospital that really require some help with us. I'll use one example of a case I'm actively working on just now. For example, the client's is an inpatient at Hermes Hospital since May. It's not yet discharged. They're working on a discharge programme, NHS and support. So just say, for example, there was a reason for her to... She had capacity, but it was the pressure and the worry of the debt was really compounding the health issues. And I've seen in some previous evidence, like saying, well, statutory moratorium, 6 months, so on and so forth, but it's what happens after that. And that's just what we're talking about, having an extension on that, you know. So that's... But having said that's one example of a case, you know, when she discharged, it could be another 6 months, a year. I mean, that's quite an extreme situation. But I'm dealing with other cases. For example, yesterday I did two energy grants to the Home Heat Support Fund applications, and both of those clients had significant energy debt. Both of them had mental health problems. They're getting adult disability payments. One person, her brother, is caring for her, looking for the other one's a sister. Is looking out for her. So you get people like that. If it wasn't for the fact that they were tenants, one's housing association and one's council, it wasn't the fact they were kind of social housing tenants, it wasn't for the fact that that they don't have any other significant debts, then we could be looking at the moratorium. But if you change that round to someone who maybe had significant debts, maybe were homeowners, had equity in the properties, then you would be looking at a mental health moratorium over and above what would be a statutory moratorium. One of the things in the working group that we had discussed was it would be a mental health professional that would be kind of a signing off on the level of mental health issues that the person would have. So the money advisor would be going with that, you know, but to have it just purely done as a compulsory order, I think it's very restrictive. And certainly, I'd like to see more on the draft regulations, you know, to see how it's going to be delivered. There was a talk about the accountant bankruptcy was going to do a portal, a separate portal, like for the statutory moratorium, doing another one with that could reach out to all the creditors as well. But having it too restrictive to just to someone who's got a compulsory order.
Put you on the spot, but when you're dealing with clients, what proportion of them will have, a compulsory treatment order, and what proportion will have a mental health issue that's clearly impacting on their management of debt, but they don't have that compulsory treatment order? Yeah.
One this financial year. Yeah.
The vast majority
are active in the community, but they've got care and support. They've got CPNs. They're kind of regularly going outpatients and whatever. So there's a lot more. So
how would you? So if it wasn't based on compulsory treatment, what could that qualifying criteria be? How would you expand? How would you define that qualifying criteria beyond compulsory treatment?
Well, just now we have, and Money Vice Sector, we have the debt and mental health evidence form. I like to think you may have seen it or had it distributed. Yeah. I've got one copy here, but I can certainly send it on to the clerk on us. And that's normally had to be completed by a mental health professional or even a social worker. The social worker would be basing it on evidence, that medical evidence that they have. And basically, it details how the person's mental health is in relation to dealing with the debt and the pressures of the debt. Can they handle it? Is there any issues? Do they understand financial issues? Or is it the pressure of the debt is the thing that's tipping them over? So there are, you know, kind of three significant questions there. And when it's put down, that's down to a medical professional. So it could be a GP. Obviously, we'd be doing it based on possible any psychiatric reports that they have. It could be a CPN, a community psychiatric nurse, and, you know, a psychiatrist, psychologist, whatever. But it would be down to what they consider the capability of that person at dealing with the debt and the finances and what risk they're under that pressure. So that is a good basis to start with. You know, and that was brought out at the working group, the CFT moratorium working group, and I was a bit disappointed that wasn't in the final report. Bear in mind, there's a lot of contributing, different organisations were providing evidence at that, you know, but I would be saying it's down to basically the mental health professionals and how they assess the individual. Is it dealing with the finances, whether the financial pressure is tipping them over, and then that's causing further exasperation or anxiety. It's making worsen the health problem.
So that's very helpful. I don't know if Natalie or Alan want to add anything to the position that Joe's outlined there.
Well, I agree, fully agree with using debt and mental health evidence form as a trigger for the moratorium. The only obstacle to it at the moment is that some health professionals still charge for it. I think not as much as they used to in the past, because maybe more people know about the form and what it means and what it can do. But it is sometimes a prohibitive factor. However, we do use that particular form in our advice process quite a lot. Because it does allow to capture the difficulties client might have. It does say specifically how their mental health condition affects how they deal with money. It doesn't just stipulate that somebody has, I don't know, bipolar disorder or somebody has depression. We all know mental health is quite fluid. One diagnosis doesn't mean exactly the same thing for everybody. So that's maybe another thing to work on, to give guidance to medical professionals what should be in the form to make it as helpful as possible. Because sometimes, even if they agree to fill in the form, it is not very meaty, it's not very specific. It just sometimes means that they say, oh, client suffers from such and such, patient suffers from such and such. And when the creditors look at the form later, they are struggling to see how that impacted clients' decisions in that particular situation in reference to the debt that they have. So, yeah, I think the form would be a fantastic tool to be used as a trigger for moratorium. And I fully agree. We see hundreds of clients who have very significant mental health problems. Evidently, even contacting us is something that is triggering them. It's difficult. They miss appointments. They don't respond to our correspondence. Sometimes we have to actually make it. We have to forewarn them that we are going to call from a specific number. We have our own mobiles so that the client recognizes who is calling them, who is trying to contact them. And yet these people are not subjected to any compulsory treatment because maybe they don't need compulsory treatment, or maybe because there is a waiting list to be actually seen by a mental health professional. So it might mean that people who otherwise would fill all the criteria that are required are not ticking the boxes yet, just simply because they are waiting in the system for their problems to be recognized. And that form allows those closest to them, social workers, support workers, CPNs, to inform the creditor about difficulties the client has. And I think that's amazing too.
If I can just come in, very short point. If we look at the English bereavement space, which is basically the equivalent of our statutory moratorium, and then you've got the English bereavement space for mental health crisis tool, I think the number of ones that are used for mental health crises is about 1.4% of the total number that are used for the normal bereavement spaces. If we use a similar model to that used in England, and the percentage is roughly the same, 1.4%, you're probably talking about 50 a year. So if you do take that model, we're talking about passing a bill that's going to help 50 people a year at best. And I don't even know if it would be that amount, because we are different. We do have a better and a moratorium that lasts for 6 months, where their moratorium lasts for 2 months. So I think, if you want this to help people, then I think you really need to look at that, because otherwise it's going to be really restrictive. And is it really worth it for the sake of 50 people a year? Do you know what I mean?
That's very helpful.
Okay, Michael Chapman.
Thanks very much, Claire. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning, and thank you for what you've said so far. I'm continuing on this question of the relationship between you as money advisers and the kicking in or not of the mental health moratorium. Natalia, you spoke quite clearly about even contacting you being a trigger and potential hurdle for people. And there've been suggestions about, who would actually make the application for the moratorium, and how that person, if it's the money advisor, would have the effect, the right information. Do you see a situation where you as money advisors could actually be gatekeepers in a way, and potentially given a responsibility that you don't want in that role? Is there another way of looking at that the process of how the moratorium would come into place if we get the criteria for it sorted out?
I think the first issue is that we have to recognise that not all people who have problems with mental health and debt are going to cross our doors and are going to come and seek help. So those who already do, I would say they're already in a good position because they recognise they have a problem and they recognise they need assistance. Okay. I would imagine that for those ones who have that awareness, it wouldn't make a massive difference to us as money advisors to what we are doing now. I think the issue, a new issue, is with people who maybe lack that awareness or who potentially could be referred to us by mental health professionals. So I think that cooperation would be very useful. Mm-hmm. I think there would need to be some sort of a way that is, written out somewhere, some procedure, because we have to adhere to data protection, we have to adhere to all the regulations, where mental health professionals, with agreement from the client, could potentially refer them onto us like any other organisations do. For example, they recognise that the client's current mental health state is triggered by existence of the debts. and they would like the organisation like us or any other to discuss this with the client. It can be a soft referral. It can be just telling the client, you know, there's this service. They have that advice available. Please go and seek it. Mm-hmm. It can be a more formal referral where they genuinely send us a referral form and say, this client in the meeting expressed that they are struggling. I'm not sure if they are going to try and reach you because of the problems that they have at the moment. They are finding it difficult to make a decision. They are trying. It is a lot for them to actually make a phone call, to even appear in the outreach. Would you mind trying and contacting them? I don't think that would change a lot. We get referrals as it is from the council, from other organizations. It would be pretty much the same. I would just be more concerned about the data protection aspect of it and honing the way where it is going to be a bit structured and the same.
Can I come in here on this point quite quickly? There is a practical, there's an operational problem with this because if you look at our current moratoriums, which are fantastic in the sense that, you know, you could go on yourself online, put register it, it comes on within 24 hours, and that's you've got protection for 6 months. You don't need to wait to see a money advisor. You don't need to get an appointment. You don't need to go through somebody deciding whether or not you, you deserve it or not. And I can understand your concern about gatekeeping. The problem, though, with this is well, first of all, we're dealing with people who possibly don't have that ability because of their mental health crisis. So I think maybe to, looking at money advisors as gatekeepers in this concept, context is wrong because really what we're trying to do is a system. But there's another issue, and it's about what the effect of the moratorium is. Because if you look at the English Bereavement Space moratorium, one of the effects is it can freeze interest and charges. In Scotland, our moratoriums don't freeze interest and charges. Now, this was actually raised during the coronavirus, because I think an amendment was laid by Jackie Bailey in the coronavirus bill about freezing interest and charges in the moratoriums. And one of the problems with that, the accounting bankruptcy raised at the time, is if you do that, then you have to give notification to the creditors, which basically means you need to tell the creditors. We don't need to do that at the moment with the current moratorium. So if you've got 10 creditors and you're having a mental health crisis and you apply for a mental health moratorium and you've got to notify, we need to know how that's going to happen. Is it the accountant bankruptcy going to notify them? How are we going to get a list of the creditors? How are we going to get their account numbers? Because the person might not be in a position to deal with them. And I think in that context, that's why maybe our money advisors, I don't think that removes the problem. I think there is issues, but that's one of the operational problems I think they need to explain. If this is going to freeze interest and charges, from what they've said in the past, we need to notify the creditors. We need to know, and how do we find out who the creditors are? And I'm sure Natalie will tell you, that's a really difficult problem sometimes. How do we get their account numbers? And who's doing that? Are we doing that? Or is it the accountant bankruptcy doing that? So I think that's an operational issue with it as well.
No, that's really helpful. And I mean, I suppose there's a question, there's a general question, you know, would you support moratorium if there was the freezing of interest and interest rates and charges in that way?
Yeah, I mean, I would support the moratorium. And I think the whole issue, and it's maybe not been highlighted enough, is what does this moratorium do, right? The current statute of moratoriums stop all diligence and they stop somebody being made bankrupt unless a petition's already been raised for bankruptcy. What does this moratorium do? In England and Wales, their breathing space moratorium, it stops somebody raising a court action, ours don't. It stops, it freezes interest and charges, ours don't. It stops cars being repossessed, ours don't. It stops evictions, ours don't. It stops repossessions, ours don't. It stops BPM meters being forcibly installed, ours don't, which is an issue because that's a reserve matter for the UK Parliament. It stops debt arrears, it stops arrears for electricity and gas bills being deducted from a prepayment meter. Ours don't. So I think there's a big issue right here. What is this going to do that's going to make it better or more enhanced than a current statutory moratorium? Because at the moment, we don't know.
Okay, that's really helpful. Just a couple more. Sorry, Joe,
you're talking about the gatekeeper. We look at it as a multi-agency approach because we have NHS, we have social work, you know, whether it's social worker, whether it's mental health officer. The way I like using the analogy is the football team. You know, basically, we're playing the ball from the back. You know, it could be mental health, social work. They cross the ball in and then the money advisor puts the ball in the back of the net. But it's a team approach. Yeah. Thank you. we're all playing a part. So it's not just the money advisor doing it themselves. It's basically there's a lot of coming together. we will do our bit, the mental health professionals will do their part, the social work will do their part, if there's a social work involved. And sometimes it's the money advice who sees something with a client, and can maybe sometimes they're in with a relative and think, have you discussed this with your doctor or whatever? Because some people we have coming in, they haven't seen a doctor in several years, and basically they're bottomed out because of the debt pressures. And so it's just identifying that and then saying, well, you know, go and speak to your doctor and then maybe go down that route. But it very much is a kind of, it's multi-agency teamwork, you know, to, you know, so we'll play our part. But we're not in total control. We're not monopolising it, but it's...
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I wasn't trying to suggest questions around gatekeeping. And I think you make the point about the partnership, collaboration and multi-agency approach being really, really important. And I'm wondering whether there's enough either in the actual legislation or in the guidance that might come around this. Or what would you like to see to support that? Because Natalia, you mentioned, you know, that the people who come to you have already... are already in a better place than many people who just either can't or don't know about it, all that kind of thing. What are the things that we need to make sure are in place so people do actually know that you exist, that there is support for mental health, the care and support in the community, Jo, that you talked about earlier on, so people don't fall through the cracks? How can we use this legislation and this process to plug some of those gaps?
Place a little bit to what Alan said, what this moratorium is going to offer, because it's true that statutory moratorium, we use it a lot at work. I'm yet to meet a client who applied for it themselves, even though they have ability. It's super easy form. We make people aware that it even exists. People don't know. But in reality, yes, it's limited. So it doesn't even stop the creditor from starting the action. It just stops the creditor from acting on it. So in that 6 months, the creditor can obtain a decree, and when the 6 months is gone, they can just use it to arrest wages, I don't know, go to the bank account and so on. So if that moratorium really, particularly during the first period of time where people need to focus on their mental health, and I think that's a very important part of this proposal, that we recognise that when you have a mental health crisis or when your mental health is generally so bad that you need to take time out, you need to pause, this isn't time to think about your debts. Yeah. This is the time for you to recover, to focus on your treatment, whatever it might be. And then when you feel better, this is the time to start slowly going into the process of addressing your debts. And I think that slowly is also crucial, because it can't be like this, that it is like as if a knife cut it. You are unwell and now you're fine and we are just going to throw it all at you. So if people know that, particularly in this first moment, the interests are stopped, the charges are stopped, correspondence is stopped, there is no court action that is going to be started, everything stops, then I think that would be a massive incentive, and that is something that can be advertised. And I think it would really meet the need out there in the community. And I think that can be used as a massive incentive.
I mean, otherwise, if it just does what a statutory moratorium does, we'll just apply for a statutory moratorium. We've got 6 months. Do you know, why would we waste our time doing all the extra work when we can just do it online and get it tomorrow? Yeah. It's simple.
Okay. No, that's really... I know others want to come in, so I'll leave it there, Claire.
Thank you. Brian?
Thank you. Good morning, panel. And thank you for coming out. I mean, listening to what you said, I'm really interested around the practicalities. And Alan, you talked about what we're trying to solve here. You know, what's the problem we're trying to solve here? And I think looking in an ideal world, you know, somebody having mental health issues will be in, will seek treatment, and during that treatment, they'll then come to you. But the reality is that's not the real world. The real world is, in mental health, a lot of people will hide it. You know, so therefore won't be in. Under the auspices of treatment. So I think from my perspective, what I would like to ask is around the skill set required from yourselves. Do we have that skill set? Is there extra training required? Do we have the practicality, the practical skills to be able to identify, deliver, on what the bill's trying to achieve here? My slight concern is around practicality of what we're trying to do here. I know, Natalie, you talked about very much around the need to identify those who would benefit from mental health, and you discussed very clearly those. You know, there's so much of a scope within mental health that not all people with a mental health issue will need this. So how are we going to identify this? How are we going to make sure that we don't drop the ball here?
That was the problem we had. We identified this issue in our own service, that we have to have a way to reach out to people rather than wait for them to appear in our office. And we've really tailored our advice model to try and answer the demands of the clients. So at the moment, we are actually offering advice mainly in outreaches, so that it's easier for the client to come out and seek advice in a familiar place rather than go to the building they don't know. Very often we are present in the pantries, and we are just there giving people a chance to come to us and talk to us. We also have a separate project. We sought funding for that, where we offer support to men whose mental health is affecting them in a way where they are struggling to engage with services, or who have attempted to take their own life. We are trying to have good working relations. Like it was said, it's a teamwork with the local council. In my previous organisation where I worked, we had very good working relations with the GP practices. At the moment as well, we have a couple of GP practices where we have our own outreaches. And we do get referrals sometimes from the GPs with the permission of the client. If the GP recognises that there is an issue there, they will let us know and the client can be seen in the clinic. So I think the skill set is there. There is a way around this. It does demand a little bit of flexibility. I think I dare to say it demands funding, because it all costs money. But we as money advisors have access to quite good training platforms where face-to-face or via e-learning we can get really good mental health training. There is the mental health first aid, there is Matrix Learn, where there are very good units on supporting clients who are vulnerable. We go out to trainings organized by our own bureaus with mental health professionals. So I would say, yes, there is this ability to recognize issues with the clients and recognize what can be the trigger or the client is at a point of crisis. I think it comes with the job as well, because we like regularly see clients at the door who come in with no appointment, bags in hands, lost their house, or who say that essentially if they don't get help, they are going to go and end their life.
I mean, I was just going to say that money advisors are quite skilled people in terms of, you know, they'll tell you they're accountants, they're lawyers, they're social workers, and they're mental health workers, because they pretty much do a bit of everything. And large numbers of the money advice clients, they have mental health problems up to a varying level. It might just be anxiety, but, you know, sometimes it can be a lot more severe. So there is a lot of skills in the money advice sector, with especially about identifying mental health problems, working with people with mental health problems. I think the only thing is, especially at times like this with the cost of living crisis, it's putting increasing strains on money advice services and money advisors personally. Because obviously if you're working under that sort of environment and dealing with very ill clients all the time, then emotionally, you know, in terms of the well-being of money advisors themselves, so that can really be eroded quite quickly, you know, and it has an impact on money advisors. But in terms of the skills set, I think, you know, obviously it varies compared to somebody who's just started and somebody who's been doing it for 10, 20 years, but, you know, there's certainly a lot of skills there. And it is, isn't that Natalia says, it's about funding as well, making sure that we can actually retain those advisors. But my big concern is the effect it has over time on the advisors, you know, to take these problems home with them, especially if you're short-staffed or you're under-resourced, and has an impact on their well-being. And you do end up seeing a lot of maybe advisors going off themselves with stress and sickness because of what they're dealing with on a daily basis.
Thank you.
I've been money advisor for 20 years, 13 years I'm training and development, and I train our advisors. We're up to date for the training. And it's, as Natalia said, there's external training. There's internal training we do ourselves, in-house with Money Matters Advice Service. It's also the council-wide training we've done, and the that's always available in that respect. And well, Natalia mentioned a few things. I've done a SUS training, that's a suicide awareness training as well. And a good money advisor, as Alan says, is trying to hold on to the good money. Not seasoned, you know, the ones that got that experience. There's a lot of pressure, there's no doubt about it. Taking the job home, sleepless nights, it's not unusual, particularly when you're worried about a client and losing the house or whatever, or even concerned about their health. But one of the biggest attributes for anybody in the front line, money advice, welfare rights officer, whatever, is the ability to build that rapport with an individual, to get to understand them, to get them to trust you. And it's the same throughout, NHS, social work, it's the same. It's having that ability, that's not just a paper exercise, that it's having that ability to build that rapport with people. And also for them, to try and give that kind of the advice, in the right level, make sure the person's capable of taking it on. Over the years, I've had to say, bring in a family member, a friend, or whoever you trust well, who's going to be able to talk you through this. Could be the carer or whatever. But as I said, there's a lot of training, there's a lot of knowledge, there's a lot of sharing. And of course, within the council environment, the housing officers are the same. They're trained up to identify if they've got a tenant that's maybe got issues. Should they be, go to NHS, go and speak to a social worker, speak to a money advisor. Social workers are the same as well. There's a lot of good people out there. There's a lot of good training. There's a lot of good information available. Yes, there's a concern about the capacity issue. There's no doubt about it. But if everyone can play their part, as I said earlier on, we can do our bit. If the NHS can do their bit, and social work and everyone else, then obviously we're part of a team. As Natalia said as well, we've got links workers. Well, it's not council, but links workers working out of GP practices. And part of their remit is basically to refer out to likes of council services, either citizen advice or other community projects that can help the person, whether it's doing a debt or whatever, or even get job coaching or whatever. But sorry if I've rambled on a bit there, that's okay.
One of the things I was going to say, Joe, you raised this issue of this bill will affect very small number of people. Mm-hmm. And to your point, Joe, you'd like to see, that there are those with capacity issues that are out with the confines of this bill at the moment. Mm-hmm. But then you've also talked about resource.
Yeah.
So I think my concern would be around the way the bill is drafted is to ensure that we don't run out of resource.
Yeah.
But we want the whole point of the bill is to help those who are in real need. So where are we in that sort of
if I would add to that, we're already dealing with some of these people, but they don't have enough protection. Mm-hmm. So this would, if we're given the right procedures, as now I'm talking, but expanding it, the fact is we're given better protection. Mm-hmm. That's the thing. We already are. It's not a case it's we're not dealing with any clients just now who've got no mental health issues whatsoever. Mm-hmm. It's getting them better protection and more extended protection. If someone's ongoing 2, 3, 4 years of ongoing treatment, it's like the statute moratorium is 6 months protection. If someone is going to be required treatment, I, as well as people through my job, and I'm aware of other people in the area where I grew up in Glasgow, the fact is you're aware of neighbours and things like that. You have people in the community who've got problems. People come to me in the street and speak to me. When I say street, they come and tap my door or see me at a football game at my Queen's Park, man. So there we go. And speak to me because I've got a foot in the door as far as that's concerned, is pointing people in the right direction. So some people already are on our caseload just now. Some are already existing clients, but it's trying to extend that protection, trying to give them that scope to allow them to get treatment, to get protection, and until such time, hopefully they're well enough and they're able to stand on 2 feet and move on. So they're here already. There's also going to be new clients, but they've already got them as it stands.
I think there is an issue. It's a valid point, though. If that we make something that's really good and gives a lot of people a lot of protections, you might get a lot of more health and social care workers starting to refer more clients on to advice agencies because they'll see, oh, this is great, it's got a high profile, it really could help my clients. And if the procedures are quite complicated, we've got to notify the creditors and all that stuff, then it does have an impact on services. Obviously, you may be creating further work, and if you widen it so it's not just 50 people a year, you know, so there's a lot of factors. And the problem with this bill is obviously, as you know, in terms of the moratorium, the meat's not on the bones. We don't know any of this yet, you know, in terms of we don't know what effect it's going to have. We don't know what the application process is going to have. We don't know who it's going to apply to. Without knowing that, it's really difficult to comment on what impact this is. Is it going to be something we want to use for our clients? If it is, how many clients are going to use it? And then what impact is that going to have in services? We don't know at this point in time because there's no meat in the bones in terms of...
Thank you. Kevin Stewart, did you wish to come in on this? And then I'll bring in Myrtle Fraser on the next one.
Thank you, Convener. And, you know, I know that sometimes when folks see this kind of bill, they want all of the meat there and then. But actually, this session, this inquiry, and the scrutiny of all of this gives us the opportunity to go into more depth to make sure that the bill actually is the right one and is helping folk. Joe was talking about rambling on, and I don't think you have today, and I think what the evidence that you have given today has been extremely useful. And, you know, I think this is the first time, and I stand to be corrected, but I think this is the first time during the course of the oral evidence that we've actually heard folk talk about the debt and mental health form to any huge degree. And I think for many folk who will have watched this and who won't have looked at all of the background, that will be a new thing for them. So I think, you know, what you've done today is actually shone some more light in all of this. I want to come back to what I think is one of the most important points in all of this, which may not necessarily require a huge amount of change in terms of legislation or regulation. Because you have talked today around about the training that you have undertaken, that your frontline staff have undertaken around about assist. I'm sure that many of your folk, if not all of them, have done trauma-informed practice training and various other things. What we're not sure about, in terms of the evidence that we've had, is what training is being done on the other side with mental health professionals, social workers and others around about their knowledge, around about debt advice that they can pass on to their clients. Now, you know, in some areas, other areas of business, government, local authorities have come together and put in place toolkits so that everybody knows what is required in terms of doing the best for the person. And I just wonder, from your general knowledge, whether you've done anything locally around about toolkits for social workers, for mental health professionals, for others that you are dealing with on behalf of clients, if anything like that has been done previously in order that, you know, we get the smoothest possible journey for folks at sometimes the most traumatic times. If I could ask Joe first, that would be useful. Thanks, Convener.
Yeah, in the part, well, not in recent times because of, I think, with COVID and cost of living crisis, I don't know what it is, but we haven't done it as often as possible. Some of the South Lancashire Council, they have Linen Line, which is a sort of an intranet. It's an internal council sort of training as well. We've also do webinars, which basically it's... I've done them in the past. One of my colleagues, David Hartness, he's a welfare rights officer, kind of guru for South Lancashire Council, and he does webinars, and to that is invited the social work staff, as a staff, you know, to attend about to for information sessions. We also, and this is probably something that probably we need to do more, to be perfectly honest, is doing more of the face-to-face meetings. You know, we use Teams for as obviously came out with COVID, you know, but I sometimes find the face-to-face training events tend to be sort of more informative, because you can look around the room and you can see who's taken it on board, you know, and it's easier for people to ask questions. But certainly, we've done it in the past. We continue to still offer it, but what needs to be probably is, if we're looking at this kind of a new moratorium, then yes, there should be more, you know, probably more information, more kind of a, you know, and I say, particularly in social work, there's been, I don't know what it's like other councillors, but I know there's a kind of a, there's a turnover in staff every so often, and you get the new social workers in training. So obviously, part of the remit for their training is obviously to understand what's on offer from like Money Matters Advice Service, with Welfare Rights, for Debt Advice, and also from other departments.
So obviously, your own local authority seems to be or have been on the ball. Obviously, there have been blips over the past week while in terms of some of this. But nationally, we don't have a set toolkit in terms of advice and help for everyone involved in this. Do you think that that would be beneficial?
Definitely. Because it would be, because then it sets a national standard. We have national standards for information and advice, you know, which has been set down, and that's for, you know, for whether it's money advice, housing advice. And so I think having a national toolkit would be good, because then we know that everybody, and it's healthy as well in respect of, if it's stipulated nationally, then the fact is, then it's not a case that you can go from one area, it's a postcode lottery, that it's going to be different types of level of information and advice. Plus, obviously, there's going to be kind of a standardisation. So if you're dealing with creditors or whatever, then they exactly know what's involved.
Grant, thank you, Joe. Natalia, do you have any other comments on that?
I'm thinking about it now.
So while you're thinking, I'll tell you what my thinking is here, because we have in place a toolkit which came into play around about homelessness, so that, you know, folk are following or should be following the same kind of things. And that toolkit can be added to, you know, with a wealth of knowledge that comes in from various professionals who are dealing with homelessness. So do you think something like that, with a flexibility around about it so it can change, so that we keep the knowledge up to date, would be useful?
I think yes, to a degree, with the flexibility added.
Yeah.
I think that there is already, like mentioned, we have national standards for debt advice.
Sure.
We have a common financial statement. I know that there's conversation around whether it is going to exist in its current form or should we change it. So there is an element of standardization in this. And I think we have to recognise that as well, service is slightly different coming from the council or housing association and from the independent advice agencies. I'm lucky to come from the agency that has support of the wide network.
Sure.
There are small agencies that don't have that, and they are maybe rural up north in Scotland. They might find it more difficult to tick some things off the boxes or utilise the toolkit fully. So I think we have to recognise that agencies will maybe dip in and dip out and take different things from it. I think definitely there is a requirement for a standard of debt advice that has to be provided, certain things that has to be done, even by the advisor, even from the point of the view of the creditor, so they know what to expect. From the point of view of the debtor, they know what to expect, how they can be helped. And if that can be done as some sort of a recommendation, then that's fantastic.
You're looking at this, and I understand why, from the debt advice side.
Is it, sorry, but, Mr. Shear, is it possible to make some progress? We're a bit pressed for time.
Very briefly, you're looking at it from the debt advice side, and I understand that, because that's who you folks are. But do you think that it would be helpful, a toolkit like that, for the likes of GPs, the link workers that Joe spoke about, to follow the same lines in terms of getting the right advice for clients as well? So not just the toolkit for debt advice, but for all who are involved in this process and helping folk.
Definitely.
Thank you very much. Thank you, convener.
Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. Good morning to the panel. I wonder if I can broaden the discussion to a different topic. And we've heard quite a lot of evidence as a committee from those we've spoken to about the minimal asset process bankruptcy. And some witnesses have said that they would like to see the current restriction on applying for that, which is 10 years, be reduced to 5 years. And it's fair to say we've heard arguments for that and arguments against that. So I'm interested to get any perspective you might have on what impact that change might have on your clients and what difference would it make if they had to apply for full administration bankruptcy instead of the minimal asset process.
Yeah, if I can come in, I mean, I can maybe give the panel a very short brief history about why we end up with minimum asset bankruptcy. Scotland actually was the first to introduce what we, I suppose, now call bankruptcy light, which was actually a low-income asset bankruptcy in 2007 or 2008. And this was even before England introduced the debt relief orders. We used to charge people £100 per application. I think in 2012-13 that went up to £200 because we've caught following a full cost recovery process. The number of low-income bankruptcies dropped off because of that. 2013, we brought through a new version of it called the minimum asset bankruptcy, which had limits on the amount of debt you could include, and also it only lasted for 6 months rather than 12 months. And all that was with the purpose of reducing the cost to the public purse of administering a minimum asset bankruptcy so we could bring the price, the cost of it, applying for it, down to £90 rather than £200 so we could increase in take-up. The reason why we said it, you could only do it every 10 years, I never really understood that, but I think it was just that thing that happens when you're cautious with a new thing and you don't want people to just keep doing it. But the reality is, if somebody qualifies for a minimum asset bankruptcy, whether they've done it, you know, if, even if they've done it 5 years ago, that somebody who has no assets, they have no heritable property, they don't, are not going to be able to pay anything. Right, so who does this benefit from stopping them doing it again after another 5 years, which they can do if they can do a full administration bankruptcy? What's the benefit of not preventing them, making them have to do it, wait 10 years before they can do it again? Because if they do the full administration bankruptcy, it does take 12 months, it does cost more to administer, so it has an impact on the public purse. It means that the client basically remains bankrupt for 12 months rather than 6 months, which really it doesn't have any benefit for the creditors, because if you qualify for a minimum asset bankruptcy, you never make a contribution. So my point is, I think we've got caught up in this whole moral issue about, you know, whether they should be able to do it twice in 10 years. And you think, well, why not? Because people, they can do a full administration bankruptcy. The purpose of the minimum asset bankruptcy, make the light version of the bankruptcy, was it's actually cheaper to administer for the public purse. It doesn't actually make any difference to the creditors because they never get a dividend payment anyway because the person doesn't have any money. And it's about getting the poor sort of financially excluded person in and out of the system, almost giving them a quick wash, almost like they do in America, their ones last about 4 months, and getting them hopefully, because a lot of people might put off getting a job again or, you know, while they're bankrupt, they'll say, I'll wait till my bankruptcy's finished. So it has no benefit. So if you can actually get somebody in, get it dealt with, they've no assets, no money, they've kind of paid anyway, get them out, basically, then it's beneficial for them because maybe, hopefully, then they'll go on, maybe become economically active again. It's cheaper for the public purse. So I don't see any logic to it at all for that point of view.
Great. Natalia or Joe, do you agree with that?
Yeah, I concur, because obviously the full administration bankruptcy requires 6 month reviews over 4 years. So whether it's the accounting bankruptcy acting, acting as a trustee or some insolvency petition, if there's a kind of contribution, the fact is they're having to take that time and effort to do the 6 month reviews. Sorry, I'm looking. It's basically it's, you know, yeah, it's from good money after bad, and it makes it a bit more seamless sort of thing.
Great. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener. Just a couple of quick questions here. You've already touched on the role of a money advisers in connection with the mental health moratorium, but it's recommended that money advisers should actually have the role of applying for a mental health moratorium on behalf of the person concerned. Do you have any views on that and how it might work and how complicated it might be?
Well, if I can be quite quick on this, because I know time's pressing. There is an issue. If the person has got a capacity issue, then we can't act on their behalf unless somebody else can act on their behalf. So we need somebody with a power of attorney or a guardianship order. Do you know what I mean? Because ultimately, if you lack mental capacity to instruct us, then obviously we need somebody that does have it. So that's the first issue. Now, obviously, people who are having mental health crises, They may still have capacity, you know, and that may be a doctor's decision whether somebody has a capacity. But there is an issue as well about how much can they assist us, you know, because if we go back to the point that Maggie made about the, you know, about interest and charges, if we have to notify people, how, you know, we need this person to be able to give us information about their debts, what debts they've got, what the account numbers are. So if they've got diminished capacity, they may have still capacity to instruct us, but if their capacity is diminished, then it can still be operationally really quite difficult because we still need to get a lot of information off of them to basically do this if we're going to have to do notification to creditors. So, yeah.
Natalia?
I think, yes, there is an issue of capacity sometimes, but we have this issue even now with some of the clients where I have been uneasy to... sign off sequestration or advise them that that's the route to go for without having it confirmed that they are fully aware of what they are doing. So I think that's the beauty of our job. I think that's where mental health professional involvement in this process is important. I think this is where this form as well, that the mental health evidence form can help, because that would explain the extent of clients' capacity issues. In terms of process, I think it would need to be something that is fairly straightforward, almost similar to what we do now with statutory moratorium. So it's an easy form. You can submit it and do it via AAB. There is an issue of contacting the creditors. We tend to rely on the credit reports because many clients simply don't know what they owe and to whom. So that makes it more straightforward. It does have some delay for people who have who are digitally excluded, because most of those reports require an active email address, and many of the clients don't have it or can't operate it for whatever reason. So then we have to apply on paper, and it takes time. But that ultimately can be done after the moratorium is submitted, I would imagine. So I think it's doable, but definitely we have to think about that capacity thing and in which moment the mental health professional would have to have a say, where would be the criteria where we have to seek further advice.
Joe?
Well, as far as well, my view on it, it would be the fact is that the medical health professional is making that referral to the money advisor, and the fact is that they are saying, obviously, if we expand the criteria, the fact is that if they can confirm that the person has is capacity, you know, yes, they do have mental health issue, but they do have a capacity to make decisions. Then the fact is, as I said earlier on at the working group, it was talking about the accounting banknotes being able to do a portal like they do just now, the statute moratorium. So, I mean, they say if we have that meeting with the client and then we have that medical evidence, that the fact is that they do need this protection, that they have capacity, then it's quite a simple thing just to upload, you know, that just to put that onto the system. It's obviously it's a caseload after that. Obviously, you know, we're dealing with a case. Obviously, we're contacting creditors and whatever, and acting on behalf of the client for as long as they require our service. So for purely just getting that referral from the medical professional to uploading, some would say, on a portal, the moratorium, then that shouldn't be too time-consuming. It's obviously when you start expanding the case and you're actually working the case, that's where work comes. But from just putting the moratorium on, that's not what I call excessive time, you know, consuming.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move quickly on. Something totally different. How effective is the debt advice and information package as a way of communicating the key information to people who are facing enforcement action? Are there any improvements that could be made? We have heard evidence before of some issues with that. Maybe Alan?
Probably not very much, to be honest. I mean, technically, they get a wee booklet and it does tell them they can contact Money Advice Scotland, Sets Money Scotland, Step Change and stuff, but I don't think it's actually probably a major. I don't think it's probably a major source of referrals, but I mean, I suppose it is the fact that they get one and they know who to contact. But I probably say it probably isn't that effective.
Would you say that it's simple and easy to
Yeah, I think that's the problem, isn't it? Because, you know, you don't want to give somebody... There is the account of bankruptcy day, other booklets, you know, more comprehensive booklets as well, which you can send out. But, you know, should it just be... I mean, should it be an A4 piece of... You know, a sort of A5 sheet or something rather than a booklet? I don't know. I mean, I think there's... It's always been a difficult issue, you know, how do you communicate things to people effectively? You know, how do you tell them to get advice? But I think you... I suppose you could slim it down to an A5, you know what I mean? But at the same time, you know, because really all you're really wanting to get somebody is if you need to help, you know, contact these are phone numbers you can phone. I mean, that's effectively the core message you're wanting to get to people. But would that make it more readable? And people read it more? I don't know.
Thank you. I'm going to stop there because I'm conscious of time.
Thank you. In terms of diligence, so the bill does make some limited... fairly technical changes to diligence, but we have heard calls for increasing for reforming the earnings part of diligence. There's been suggestions that the amount protected should go up to £1,000. There should be a system of deductions which takes account of family size that reflects on the local government committees, not local government committees, sorry, but the parliamentary inquiry, Robin Peter to pay Paul, I think, made that as a recommendation. And also introducing some flexibility into the system for creditors so they could reduce the amount if it was relevant to helping the debtor support their liabilities. I know, Alan, you've done some work on this. Do you want to talk to the committee about
that? Yeah, I mean, if I can. I mean, obviously, you know, this is a difficult one because, obviously, the origins of this start back in 1987, even further back, 1985, when the Scottish Law Commission did the report on diligence and debtor protection. And they brought forward the modern earnings arrestment. And the amount that actually was protected, you know, was started out as £152 per month, and that was in 1987. And obviously, for I think up until 2009, it went up with the medium amount by average weekly earnings. 2009, then I think it switched to the CPI, the average, you know, whatever Consumer Price Index was. And then in 2023, I think it's now been back to the median earnings. I don't know how they do it exactly. But how I've looked through hands up and stuff like that, and I've tried to figure out how did they ever come with this figure of 152 in the first place. You know, at the time, if you look at the Scottish Law Commission's report on it, they looked at a number of different options. They looked at, for example, some countries set the protected minimum amount against minimum wage. And obviously, in 1987 or 1985, the UK didn't have a minimum wage. Some countries set it against the personal allowance for tax. And if I can give you examples very quickly, I mean, in 1987, you know, the protected minimum amount represented 70% of what we our personal allowance for tax purposes. It's now 62%. At some points, it's been down to 50%. So the idea that this minimum protected amount has held up against, you know, if you compare it with the protected your personal allowance for tax purposes, it's significantly dropped. And in actual fact, in 1985, it was its highest because it was actually 125% of the personal allowance. But as I say, now it's down to 62%, and last year it was down to 5%. We don't have a minimum wage in 1987, but obviously we got one in 1989, and the protected minimum amount, based on somebody working 37 hours a week, was 47% of the minimum wage. It's now down to 39%. So it's significantly dropped. If you were to increase it to £1,000, which is what I've suggested, then that would bring the protected minimum amount up to 60% or 59-60% of the minimum wage in this country. In terms of the personal allowance, the amount that we don't think that people should have to pay tax, if you were to increase it to £1,000, it would probably work out as roughly about 95% of the personal allowance. Now, these were things that the Law Commission considered at the time. Mm-hmm. I think it's something we should be considering now, because I think it's, if you go bankrupt in this country, you're allowed to keep £1,000 in your bank account. Mm-hmm. If you get your wages arrested, obviously, you know I was involved in campaigning for that, but if you get your bank account arrested, obviously, since last November, you're allowed to have £1,000. Why should somebody know how to be allowed to have £1,000 in their wages at the end of the day? I mean, we're talking about 60% of the national minimum wage. That's all we're talking about, giving some basic protection to people. That's basically... And obviously, I've done a survey, and I've looked into it because I know it's pushed for time. But my experience, and I don't know if my colleagues are the same, it causes a lot of hardship. It's not based on... know whether you've got children or not got children, or two people in your house or three people in the house. Again, this is something that the Law Commission looked at in 1985. They thought it was really complex how you would do that, because obviously they're putting a responsibility on an employer to try and establish whether somebody's got a dependent child or not. So they didn't think that would be a good idea. But one example that I've always argued for is if you look at the Welfare Reform Act, UK piece of legislation, the DWP and local authorities as well can do a direct earners attachment, which is a UK earners arrangement. And one of the things that they can do under the Welfare Reform Act is they're allowed to change the amount. So if somebody contacts a DWP or a local authority when they're doing it for overpaid benefits and says to them, listen, I'm really struggling, I really can't afford this earners arrangement, I can't pay my current council tax, etc., because I've got two children or whatever, they're allowed, the DWP and local authorities for overpaid benefits, they're allowed to vary the amount of the wage arrangement. They can say, right, well, we'll reduce it. You can't do that with Scottish earners arrangement. And I think if we were to give local authorities, and I see South Lanarkshire Council has obviously supported this as well, but if we were to give local authorities that flexibility to say, when somebody contacts us and says they're having trouble with their earners arrangement, they can't afford it, and we accept that, maybe they go to the Money Advice Service and the Money Advice Service does a financial statement and gives it to the Council Tax Department, why would we not give councils the power to at least reduce the amount, though, to vary it? It's something the DWP have, it's something councils already have, when they're resting wages for overpaid benefits, but they don't have it for council tax. So I would encourage it going up, and I'm happy to share those tables in relation to the minimum wage, in relation to the personal allowance, where I can email them to the clerk so you can look at them. So I think the point is, it's never really held its value. And I think we need to look at it, and maybe, anyway, I would argue £1,000 is the right amount, and we need to give councils, or creditors, sorry, but obviously 90% of wage arrangements are actually done by councils. For council tax, we need to give creditors the power to vary the amount of a wage arrangement.
And Natalia and Joe, do you have anything to add to that in terms of your clients and the impact of wage arrangements?
You probably read the South Lanarkshire Council submission, though I wasn't directly involved in that, so... because I was on the money advice side, but this came from the council as a creditor, you know, for the council tax in particular. But the fact is, you get someone coming in, and what happens is someone gets earnings arrestment for 1 year, and then that will kind of often enough overlaps into the next year. So then they're going to run up council tax years for the subsequent year. I'm not going to say that's going to happen in every case. And in some scenarios, the earnings arrestment can then result in the person getting rent arrears, mortgage arrears, and then we're looking at a solution like we're looking at DAS, or we're looking at bankruptcy. The debt arrangement scheme, for example, the creditor's only going to get 78 pence in the pound, as you stated from the South Lanarkshire Council submission. They would rather amend the arrestment and get 100%, and particularly as we all know now, the factors like local government funding and even funding for the third sector is struggling just now. So if we can make sure that the factors that the councils have the power, you know, particularly for collection of council tax, and even not just the council tax, but the other creditors, because there's going to be some creditors who are going to be happy getting a regular amount, you know, each month, than getting potentially nothing at all. If that person, if the individual has to apply for bankruptcy, there's a fair chance there will be a zero dividend. Trustees, don't get me talking about trustees, but they're not good. But if it goes in the debt arrangement scheme, then the fact is 78% of that debt. So, you know, the fact is, I think it's having that power to vary the arrestment. And there's the precedent, as Alan said, in the direct earnings attachment, that there is something else at UK level, then the fact is, I would like to think as a caring country, that the fact is that not only caring for the individual, but being astute, and even from a commercial point of view, say, call a council or any creditor, from a commercial point of view, that's got to be more viable for them.
And Natalia, is there anything you would like to say about earnings arrangements or the impact on your client?
I fully agree. The level is not appropriate at the moment. It is adding to energy poverty. It's adding to child poverty. The wages, when they are arrested at the current level, we often have families where only one person works. So if that amount of money is arrested from their sole income, it really leaves families in destitute, severe financial hardship. And there is just nothing that we can do to try and alleviate it to the level, to bring it back to the level where people can cope. So, yeah.
And one last point. In Scots law, traditionally, there was always a saying, it was the judges that used to say it, and the saying was that diligence should always was harsh by nature, because it's a coercive form of legal debt recovery, so it's by nature harsh. but it should never be unduly harsh. The problem we've got at the moment with earnings assessment is too often it's now turning out to be unduly harsh. And the legal procedure for challenging that involves going through courts, getting a review of the earnings assessment. Clients won't do it. And there's just no flexibility built into the system. So even when you've got a perfectly reasonable creditor, and many councils are perfectly reasonable because they're also helping people with their welfare, as is other creditors who have obviously been told by the Financial Conduct Authority to be reasonable, they don't have the power to actually vary it. It's just, we've got to give them the power to vary it, because too many cases, what we're hearing, what Nat was and Tara was saying, there's too many cases where it's now been unduly harsh. That's no the point. And even in the Debt of Scotland Act, it says, you know, if it is unduly harsh, you can ask to get it recalled, but it means come through court. So the law says it shouldn't be unduly harsh, but we are seeing it every day that it is now unduly harsh in too many cases.
Okay, thank you to the witnesses for joining us today. That is much appreciated. We'll now move into private session.